The Lord has been so magnificently wonderful to His creation. And yet at times we see some of the great devastations, and we see some of the horrific diseases, and not to even mention the wars and catastrophic kinds of things that happen in the world. And yet the Lord is good. He is not the one that perpetrated all these things. We know that there was a beginning when everything was perfect and God had made everything, and He said that it was good. And as a result, a man came and defiled it. But yet His mercy is from everlasting to everlasting, and His grace is throughout all generations. On today, we're grateful again for having Brother Carl, our videographer, and his assistant, Brother Nelson, to help us to bring another broadcast here at the St. Paul Baptist Church in Baltimore, Maryland, on the Alameda. And I guess sometimes people wonder why I emphasize the Alameda. Well, there are quite a few St. Paul's in Baltimore, but I only know of one on the Alameda, and that's us. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. On today, we want to go back to the Old Testament, and we want to look at a portion of scripture out of 2 Chronicles. And if you are following along, I'll give you a little time to get there. If you find the book of Psalms, turn back toward Genesis and don't flip too far, and you'll find 2 Chronicles. You'll find it. Chapter 20, and our reading today will be from verses 19 through 24. And as always, we are looking into the King James Version, the old King James Version. It's my preference, it may not be yours. But the Word of God is alive, it's active, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, and we cannot destroy it because it has been eternally etched in the archives of glory for eternity. Amen. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 19 through 24. And the Levites of the children of the Kohathites, and of the children of the Kohites, stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel with a loud voice on high. And they rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness of Tekoah. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, "Hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall you prosper. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, and that they should praise the beauty of holiness as they went out before the army, and to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. And when they began to sing and praise the Lord, set an ambush against the children of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, which was come up against Judah, and they were smitten. For the children of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir, utterly to destroy and to slay them when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir. Everyone helped to destroy another. And when Judah came forward, the watchtower in the wilderness, they looked unto the multitudes, and behold, they were dead bodies and fallen to the earth, and none escaped. When Judah got to the battle, everybody that were fighting were dead, and none of Judah's enemy escaped. For a while, a little while, I want to talk about go face your enemy. Go face your enemy. Our Father and our God, we know ultimately that there is one enemy, and that's the enemy of all truth. But he uses so many other people and situations and in his deceitful, deviant method to fight the truth. But ultimately, Jesus the Christ, our Savior, has proved down through the years that the Lord tells us not to fear, but go face your enemy. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God's word, the Bible, contains in it and scattered throughout, mostly in the Old Testament, whereby a few of great men of God momentarily suffered spiritual amnesia and neglected to consult with the Lord before facing insurmountable odds against their enemies. Even the great warrior Joshua, he failed to consult with the Lord before going up to fight the battle at Ai, recorded in Joshua 7:5. And because he did not consult the Lord, just a small band of men defeated the army of Israel. Yes, even King Saul in 1 Chronicles chapter 10, verse 14, did not seek God's permission of who to fight and when to go to war. He messed up so badly so as that he had to go, or at least he chose to go, to the witch of Endor for help. A fortune teller, a soothsayer, a psychic lying liar. Therefore, the Lord killed him, even though Saul died at the hands of the Philistines. Yet God said, I killed him for his transgression. He was my disobedient servant. So says verse 14 of chapter 10 of 1 Chronicles. Even the great David, a man after God's own heart, had lapses of leaving God out of God's own agenda from time to time. He went about doing his own thing in his own strength without consulting or inquiring of God for his directions or his permissions. 1 Chronicles chapter 15 and 1 Chronicles chapter 21, verse 30. Our text really begins way back in chapter 18 of 2 Chronicles, verses 1 through 3. When Jehoshaphat, in some marriage arrangement for political and military advantage, joined forces with the notorious Ahab. And Ahab, king of Israel, and those following him in Israel, persuaded Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, to join up with Israel and go to war and battle at Ramoth-Gilead because they were blood relationship in the family. But they were not of the seed of the family of God, even after the prophet Micaiah had warned him, do not go with Ahab. Judah and Israel were defeated in the battle of Ramoth-Gilead. Ahab was killed, and Jehoshaphat went back to Judah, licking his wounds. He afterward repented, and God blessed him. Now, some years later, again, other enemies of Judah, the children of Moab, the children of Ammon, joined together with Mount Seir, with these Ammonites, and came a great host to battle Judah. I want you to know that your enemies will keep a coming. They'll leave you for a season, but they'll be back. Mm-hmm. Jehoshaphat was informed, given an update report in the affairs of Judah's military inadequacies to go to war against the great multitude that come up against them. From beyond the sea of the side of Syria, who had came up and camped in Hazazion Tamar in the desert of Engedi. I think I need to say that again. They came up and camped in Hazazion Tamar in the desert of Engedi. They came to make war with Judah. Jehoshaphat, the good king of Judah, had to learn his lesson the hard way and the painful way. When trouble came the first time, he went seeking help of those who were God's enemy and cared nothing for righteousness or the people of God. Now, our text says in this chapter, chapter 20, verses 1 through 3, Judah is now weak, whipped, and whimpering because of the foolish decision that Jehoshaphat made to join up with Ahab, the godless king of Israel. How many times you have to go to aid one of your, or more than one of your blood relatives? Physical blood relationship, but they have no relationship in the blood of Jesus' family. There is a great difference. You knew you weren't supposed to go. The Lord in his mercy had allowed you on many occasions before to show them his grace and goodness, and you decided you were going to help. But not this time, no more. And just like Ahab, they persuaded you to get involved. You knew that you weren't supposed to go this time, but they reminded you, blood is thicker than water. And so you went anyhow, and you got into that mess, and you brought some more family members into that ungodly situation. You signed your name, for instance, on the dotted line for one child, but you didn't sign for the other. Mm-hmm. You paid the tuition for the niece, but you didn't pay the tuition for the nephew. You allow one family member to use your car. They wrecked it and while driving under the influence, and they told you, well, it is what it is. My. You really didn't don't have anybody to blame but yourself. And you won't own up to your mistakes. You go around bad-mouthing your family members and everyone else who you have done some favors for. But God had told you not to. Don't do it. But you went anyhow. Jesus says to us, you're the head. You're not the tail. But it took you some hard knocks, some horrible experiences, some setbacks, and some growth in knowledge and wisdom of the Lord before you learn your lesson. Now, years later, Jehoshaphat has repented from relying on his own wisdom. He doesn't pretend like some folks do and act like they got it all together. They're going to man up to it and say, it is what it is, bring it on. But Jehoshaphat learned his lesson. Have you learned yours, huh? Even with your blood relative. Jehoshaphat acknowledges his fears and his insufficiency this time. When his enemies came up upon him to eat up his flesh, he positioned himself to seek the Lord. First of all, he was ready for worship. That was his first agenda this time. He acknowledges God as his go-to. The Lord was his game changer. For all of his needs, he called the people together and they prayed, and he prayed openly in the midst of the congregation. You know, when some people, when they get into trouble, trials, and tribulation that come up upon them, they ask you to pray for them. And that's good. But then you ask them, well, what do you want me to pray for you? Their reply is, just pray for me. Well, then they want you to pray that old lazy prayer. Lord, you know all about it. Well, if you ask me to pray for you, that kind of prayer, I'll do it, but it doesn't get much response from God. He's not an impersonal, strange father. He is our heavenly father. God tells him, go tell him what you want, what it is, what you need. That's why most of your effectual, fervent prayers should be in the private sea of your closet. Just you and God, and he promised to reward you openly. Now, in his seeking God first, Jehoshaphat remembers the greatness of God to his fathers, and in their prayers, he petitioned the God who is the God of heaven and earth. You, Lord God, rules over the kingdoms of all the heathens, and there is nothing in your hand that you cannot handle. There is no kingdom on earth that can withstand you. He unashamedly acknowledges and admits his total dependency on the Lord. In the New Testament, Apostle Paul conceded that is why, for Christ's sake, he said, I delight in my weaknesses, in my insults, in hardship, in persecutions, in afflictions, and in difficulty. For when I am weak, Paul said, then I am strong. Just as Jehoshaphat knew he was helpless and the army of Judah was no match for this great gathering of foes against him, with this threat and present danger pending, he recognized the power of God's presence. In his presence is the fullness of joy, and at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Secondly, this entire chapter is a continuing episode of Jehoshaphat relying upon his God. Look at verse 12. You will judge them, he says, our enemies, for we have no might against this great company that comes against us, and we don't know what we ought to do. Look what he says to God. But you do, Lord, and therefore our eyes are upon you. My, my, my. What reliance, what confidence you have in God. We don't know what to do, but you do. And therefore, we're going to look to you, Lord. We pick up this pericope in verse 19. The Levites, they are the priests. They are the children of the Kohathites, and they are the children of the Kohathites, stood up, and after they were supplicating, praying, fasting, worshiping, and praising their great God. That ought to be a prerequisite before anybody decides to do anything if you're a child of God. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him first. Mm-hmm. The old folks used to say, those who know God and can get a prayer through, I want you to pray for me. King Jehoshaphat, this time, he let the people know of this grave situation, and he begins to encourage them to trust in the Lord and believe God. Judah stood before the Lord, and in verse 14, they said, the prophet Jehaziel, one of the sons in the family of Asaph, the worship leader, the spirit of the Lord came upon him. Listen to this. I want you to know that the choir member, the Sunday school teacher, and any person in the congregation who worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness and in spirit and in truth, the Holy Spirit may begin a revival in your local assembly with you. If you're living, walking, and talking in the obedience of faith. He said to King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord, do not be afraid. Why? Because the battle is not yours. The battle is the Lord. Every battle a Christian fight is not theirs. It belongs to the Lord. He said, I want you on tomorrow, go down. And when they come up on the cliff of Ziz, you will find them at the end of the brook, in the wilderness of Jeruel. Notice, God did not tell his people, the devil is on your trail, but you go face your enemy. It really doesn't matter whether there are few of you or many of the enemies. Whoever it is, whatever it may be, makes no difference how strong they are, how long you've been bothered and defeated by them or by this thing in your past, or you're dealing with it right now, or what the odds are against you. Go face your enemy. Now this time, you go, but don't you go fighting in your strength and your abilities. Don't you use your smarts and your weapons. As a matter of fact, don't go this time to fight at all. Just go and face the enemy and stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. King David said, when my enemies and my foes came up upon me, David, the psalm writer, David, the psalm singer, David, the warrior and the music minister for his God in Psalms 27 declared that he had no fear when the Lord was with him. The Lord was his light and his salvation. When the wicked, he said, even my enemies, when they came up upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled, their legs and ankles got weak and they fell. When your enemies come up upon you and you've been in his presence, you are not afraid, you are joyful, you've been in the presence of the Lord, and when in his presence, there's fullness of joy. You have been praying, you have been praising, you have been worshiping, you've been blessing him, and now you're singing and rejoicing and remembering all the wonderful promises God had left for you on record in his word. This time, when you must go, go face your enemies. But be not like when you were foolish and like Ahab did. But this time, the Lord is with you. Your weapons of warfare are not fleshly, and they are not of man's wisdom. But your weapons are mighty through the pulling down of strongholds. Yes, that is to say, you can go face your enemy, whatever your trials, your temptation, your faults, your failures, your weakness. Go face him, face him. You can face them with confidence, with courage, with faith, with favor with God, because the battle is not yours. I'm so glad to know that when there's a fight going on in my life against me, it is not a me doing the fighting, but it's God. When you believe God, you also believe his word, because he sent his messengers. God will send prosperity your way. Your life will become a resource and a reservoir of prosperity for you and for others. Now, God's prosperity means so much more than financial and physical wealth. God is talking about a greater and a more lasting and a meaningful idea of being affluent. The Lord is too big and too awesome to limit himself to just one area of prosperity. Delight yourself in the Lord. I said, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Yes, be joyful in the things of the Lord. Be satisfied with what he's already done for you. I have learned, and I'm a witness concerning Christ-like behavior. Obedient children of God are joyful children in every situation. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, for his goodness, his mercy, his everlasting truth that endures to all generations. Be glad and happy for his goodness and mercy. He will give you everything that you need. Sick people need to get well. He'll be a healer in the hospital room. He'll be a healer on your sick bed in your home. God's people have a different perspective of what's going on around them because who is living in them? And thirdly, the text says in verse 22, when they began to sing and praise the Lord set an ambush, a trap, a surprise attack. They were confused and fighting each other. The children of Ammon and the people of Moab and Mount Seir, they came up against one another. And when they did, they killed one another. And when Judah got there, they were beaten down, troubled, afflicted, and they were defeated. God will fight your battle. Well, in the Old Testament, Jehoshaphat, in the Hebrew, Aramaic means Jehovah has judged. Yes, he will judge your enemies. Psalm 96, 11, 12 declares, let the heaven rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the sea roar and all that is in it, let the fields be joyful and all that is in them. Then shall the trees of the forest rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord, you righteous, and give thanks in remembrance of his holy name. Psalm 75, 7 attests that God is the judge. He will put down one and he'll exalt another. In the New Testament, if you don't remember, I'll tell you. Jesus came in the fullness of time. Yes, he did, to do the will of his Father. Not to judge this time, but to give life. I give his sacrifice, a ransom, a payment, be a propitiation on behalf of his Father to save his people from their sin. He was made to be sin for those who were sinners, me, you, and everybody else, and everybody that believed in him, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. He was crucified, he died, and he was buried and placed in Joseph Arimathea's tomb. But early resurrection Sunday, he got up from the dead so that we might live with him forever. And he promised that he's coming back to reprove the world of sin, of righteousness, and judgment. But he didn't leave us alone. He sent back the Holy Spirit to empower us to go face the enemy. We have the power to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Jesus faced his enemy with love and mercy. He faced his enemy with grace and forgiveness. He faced his enemy with long suffering. He faced his enemy with power over death, hell, and the grave. He counted all joy that was set before him. He endured the cross. He faced his enemies, yes, he did, with power of the word of God. Jesus went to the cross and faced his enemy and said, "It is finished," and gave up his spirit back to his Father. Therefore, you and me, we can go face our enemies. Why? Because Jesus wins and we win also. Praise the Lord for victory in Jesus when we fight against whoever it is, enemies of God and of ourselves. Amen, amen, and amen. Thank you, God, our Father, again, for letting us to know that our fight, our battles, our warfare are not ours. Because we belong to you, then we can transfer them over to you, and you will get the victory every time. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, we are excited, and maybe that's not the most robust word I can use right now, but we are doubly excited because we are making preparations to move from the lower fellowship hall and doing our videoing. Not that the videoing has not been of quality, professionalism, and expertly done, but we are, and hopefully, moving upstairs so that we can get the congregation at large back into the sanctuary, if you please, upstairs. Now, that's the physical sanctuary. I want to make sure you understand that. God has a sanctuary that he lives in your heart. But the physical sanctuary is where we used to coming together. And we want to do this. I'm looking. This is my personal statement. I'm looking somewhere. We ought to be back in this building before or around June sometime. We ought to be here. And our video man and the persons working with him around here, we are going to move all the equipment upstairs, and we're going to do the media ministry from upstairs, and we want you to be a part of that. We want you to come, and we want you to be excited, doubly excited as I am, and we know that you will. You've been praying for your local assembly, the St. Paul Baptist Church on the Alameda. You've been praying for the media ministry. You've been praying like you supposed to because you love to pray, and I know you do because I'm a part of that that throng of prayer warriors that we have and the Bible studies, but we want to come back together, and we want to see you there. Now, I don't want to tell you what to do. That's a personal choice that you make. But if you feel safe, most of the people that are work around here all summer long, all winter long, all last year, we all have been cleared, and we are in the process of being vaccinated or have been vaccinated for the most part. And we are adhering to the guidelines that have been set for both the city and the state. And so we want you to come worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Don't forget that text in 1 Corinthians when Apostle Paul writes by the unction of the Holy Spirit. He says, when you come together, chapter 11, okay? So it means physically. Yes, I know Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians about my spirit being there, and we've been worshiping the Lord in spirit and in truth, but we want to also add to that in person. We want to come in person, and if you have reservations about coming, please, sir, and please, ma'am, you pray for those who will come. I am anticipating coming, and I have been laboring for quite a while trying to give some messages that I believe the Lord will be pleased with, and hopefully that you have received them. And so there are so many things that we want to do. We want you to come and be a part of it. Who knows what the Lord might do with you in the media ministry? So many things you can learn. I've learned so many things about television and videoing, all of this. And of course, I can't remember most of it, but anyhow, I learned it. And somewhere along the line, you can do so much better than me. And we want some of our young people, you're all in college in the summer. Those of you may have summer jobs or whatever, and you might want to come and take a class. We have an instructor here that's second to none, and he has a resume of working in the media ministry for almost 20 years at one of the archdioceses in the Catholic religion, and he is well qualified, and so we want to help him. He wants to give all this ministry to the St. Paul on the Alameda church family. He has just brought so much equipment in here, and it's all a gift from him through the Lord. All a gift from the Lord through him, each way you want to say that. And we are so grateful. He is so faithful. And now we have other people who are coming in. Come on and pray one with the other. Get on the phone and tell somebody, I'm going back to church. Now, don't you ask the question, because most of the time you get on the phone, what you do? I very seldom ask people what I'm going to do for the Lord. I ask him first and let him tell me what I should do. And if I'm the only one doing it, it doesn't matter to me. Me and the Lord are more than all the world against us. So you do that. You pray with us. You get excited. And then real soon, I'm hoping June at least, we'll all be back together worshiping the Lord, giving him praise, thanking him for letting it be as well as it is. And somebody said he didn't have to do it. Yes, he did. Because he promised, and when God promises something, he puts himself on a charge, and he can't take it back. The Bible says to us that the gifts and callings of God are irrevocable, Romans 11, 29. He takes them back. He doesn't take them back at all. No, excuse me. So whatever he says, he had to do what he's doing. He had to go to the cross. He had to go into the grave. He had to get up from the grave. He had to go back to heaven, because these things were prophesied. And he said, lo, I am with you always, yea, even to the end of the world. So whatever he said he has to do, he will do. And we thank God for his faithfulness. Thank God for your faithfulness as you continue to pray with your local assembly. And we don't worry about what other people do, but we may have to join in together and do some fellowshipping with them. But we know that God has given us a charge here at the St. Paul Baptist Church on the Alameda. To God be the glory, great, mighty, and wonderful things that he hath done. And we are so glad. Amen, amen, and amen.
There's no pain, Jesus. He cannot heal. the Lord.